You and your daughter would go to bed together, and there would be one bed down there. You were having sex with your daughter, Melody, weren't you?
What people put in their bodies can alter their brain's composition. A quick and extreme example of this is substance abuse. While different substances affect the brain differently, the one we will look at today is meth and the consequences of long-term use. Chronic users have a reduced functionality of the striatum, the part of the brain that controls cognition and social behavior. More specifically, this part of the brain has many roles, including voluntary movement, it's a dopamine pathway, and regulates reward experiences. Symptoms from long-term use can be insomnia, violent behavior, and psychosis, including paranoia. The effects of insomnia and paranoia can impair one's perception of reality and make them react to something that is not actually happening. A mild and common example of this type of psychosis is the imagined sensation of insects crawling on one's skin. This is why chronic users tend to itch their arms often and end up with sores on their body. In today's video, we will look at Michael Dixon, a man who shot, sawed, and burned another man for 15 days. Michael Dixon was 40 years old and had an 18-year-old daughter named Melody. They lived in a house with a man named James Whitaker. Take note that throughout this video, we will hear James Whitaker be referred to as Jim or Jimmy. James graciously took in Michael and his daughter because they were in need of a helping hand and a roof over their head. Supposedly, Michael and his daughter lived in a single room in the basement and shared a bed. We use the word supposedly because Michael denies this sleeping arrangement, but others, including Melody, confirm this. Michael and Melody did drugs together as well. Michael says that he did meth multiple times a day for years. As previously mentioned, their corpus striatum was likely damaged due to their excessive substance abuse, and this part of the brain plays an important role in reward and reinforcement. It is possible that Michael exploited this, and Melody's brain has been trained to connect the intimacy with the reward of drugs. Michael lived in Laurelville, Ohio, where the population is just under 500 people and steadily declining. For perspective, this is the size of some high schools in the U.S. It was one night in early July 2020. Around 10 p.m., Michael and his daughter went to his friend's house to get high. Michael claims Melody was sleeping in the car while he was in the house partaking in the activities. Whether this is true or not is irrelevant to the altercation that took place that day. With that said, this is probably the first glimpse we're getting of Michael removing Melody from a story. Around 4 a.m., Michael then gets in his truck and drives back to where he resides, in other words, to James Whitaker's house. James was in his room when they arrived home, and according to Michael, James was also under the influence that night. While physical evidence that was collected can explain the orientation of the assailants and victim, the true motive may never be fully revealed. Michael gave three different stories that have two different motives, one being self-defense and one being to protect his daughter. The common thread is that Michael painted himself as having no other choice than to shoot. We will hear Michael in his court testimony recount his first version of the altercation. He will go on to explain that when they first entered James Whitaker's house, Melody went straight to the bathroom, and an altercation between him and James ensued. The altercation supposedly happened because James said that Michael must leave the residence and was not allowed to take his daughter with him.
When you walk into the front door of the house, is anyone else in the house or awake?
Not at the time, no.
Okay. So you walk in the house, and then you said your daughter needed to go use the restroom?
Yes.
Okay.
Jimmy comes out, tells me to get the hell off his, get the fuck off his property, and I ask him what his problem is.
Okay. Now, where does he come from?
His bedroom.
Okay. So you, did you see him walk out or just hear him?
At first I just heard him, then he come out and I seen he had his gun.
Okay. Do you know which gun he had?
The 1100, the Remington.
He had previously not told you to leave the household, correct?
No.
So why was he telling you in this specific instance to do this?
I don't know.
Okay. Did he appear to be in his right mind?
No.
You used drugs with him often, correct?
Yes.
Did he appear to be under the influence on this occasion?
Yes.
Okay. So you told him as soon as Melody gets out, then you'll leave?
Yes.
What did he say then?
Told me Melody wasn't going with me.
So he told you to leave, but that you had to leave your daughter there with him?
Yes.
Did he tell you why?
No.
Okay. Where's Melody at this point?
In the bathroom, behind him.
Did you leave this area at all to go anywhere else at this
point?
Yes,
I went down to the basement.
Okay. Why'd you go down to the basement?
I got my gun.
Okay. So he had a gun, and then you go and grab your gun.
Yep.
Why did you feel it necessary to go grab a gun?
Because he just didn't seem in the right state of mind, and he had a gun pointing it at me.
Okay.
The way I looked at it, any normal person that had a gun pointing at him is going to go get one.
Throughout this video, we will hear Michael's contradicting stories and lies that he told investigators. The investigator can tell from Michael's pauses and dismissing of questions that he is not being truthful. As we will see, the investigator takes Michael's hand and holds it for a minute in order to gain his trust and show that he is there to protect him. Once he realizes Michael is still not feeling safe to speak the truth, the investigator uses a combination of intimidation with a sense of comfort. He continues to hold his hand, but physically moves in closer, which is cornering Michael to give him the sense that there is no way out other than telling the truth.
And I can help you. I can talk to the prosecutors. We can get closure. Mike, I'm not lying to you, buddy. I can help you. Listen, I can help you, but you have to help me. Okay? Where can I find Jim? Where can I find him? Let me come over here to you. Come here. Listen, turn around here. Man to man. Table? No. Mike, I know you know what happened to Jim. I know. Okay? You understand that?
Mm-hmm.
Help me. And I help you. It's simple. I will not let you go through this alone. Where is Jim right now? It's okay. Give me your hand. Give me your hand. It's okay. It's all right.
We will now see Michael demonstrate another version of his story. This time, he will explain that Melody was actually present during the shooting and that he shot because he felt that her life was being threatened.
The bathroom back that away, and so you're her. You started to come out of this away. Jimmy's standing there.
Kitchen's over this way.
Yep, and Jimmy's right there, and I'm over this away. And Jimmy went because she started to come out, and you went to grab her by the neck.
So if I go out, I go to grab him, right hand or left hand?
He went to grab her by his left hand.
Left hand?
Or that would have been his right.
Okay.
Because like this? Gun in this hand.
Okay. Was the gun pointed up or down?
Kind of like pointed like at my stomach area.
So then what happened? So was his finger like on the butt of the gun?
No, it was like the butt like I showed you earlier, but he had it
on,
like
the butt.
On the trigger.
But his finger was on the trigger.
Mm-hmm.
So he had it like that. He had like this. Yeah, then what happened?
I grabbed a hold of the gun and pushed it up and it went off.
So while he still got his hand around her neck?
Well, she just started to walk in. That was like a distraction, it seemed like to me.
So his hand
was actually on
your daughter.
Mm-hmm.
Or not?
Yes, it was.
It was. Okay. So like she starts walking. So let's do it real quick.
Was like that, and I just pushed this thing up like that, and then
his finger
hit the tree.
And where did it hit his face at? Which side? If we're like this, which side?
Would have been on his right hand side.
So the gun would have been like this,
mm-hmm.
and it would have went off like that. Did she get covered with blood?
I believe a little bit.
Okay.
We will hear Michael during his court testimony describe a third version of the altercation. This time, Melody was on the floor at the top of the stairs, and James was holding a gun to her. Michael explains that he brought a gun with him when he confronted James because he heard the safety of the gun click off.
Where was Melody at the time you got up the stairs?
At the time, I didn't know, but she was on in front of Jimmy on the floor with, and he had the gun pointed at her head.
Okay. So you saw that?
Yes.
Okay. Did you hear him saying anything to Melody?
No.
Okay. Did you hear anything else?
No.
When you got up the stairs, what made you feel at that point it was necessary to shoot?
I'm really not sure.
Okay. So, did you hear anything that would have made you think that your life was in danger?
I heard the safety on his gun go click off.
Okay, well, that's a really important detail that I think we need to explore. So when you got upstairs, you heard a safety click off?
Yep.
Okay. How do you know what that sound sounds like?
If you've been around guns very much, you can know what it sounds like. It's just a click.
Okay. Have you ever used the 1100 before?
Yes, I've hunted with it many times.
So you know exactly what the sound of a safety clicking off is?
Yeah.
Okay. And you heard, you saw Mr. Whitaker up there and had seen the gun in his hand.
Yep.
And you heard the safety click off.
Yes.
Is that when you shot, when you heard the safety click off?
Yes.
Okay. Now, once the safety clicked off and you shot, where did you shoot him?
In the eye, kind of in an angle right there.
Okay. And when you hit him with the bullet, presumably, did he fall immediately?
Yes.
Okay.
Fell against the refrigerator.
Okay. Was that behind him?
Yes.
Now, where was Melody at this point?
On the floor.
Okay. And you said the gun, when you heard the safety click off, the gun was pointed at her?
Yes.
While this isn't proven with evidence, there was discussion about Melody's relationship with her father and with James. First, there was speculation that Melody and her father, Michael, were intimate. Melody told investigators that she slept in the same bed as Michael, and more happened.
You were having sex with your daughter, Melody, weren't you?
No.
So when Melody told that to law enforcement, she was lying?
Yeah.
So when Keith Strickland testified that you and your daughter would go to bed together and there would be one bed down there, he was wrong? He was lying?
Yeah.
So with respect to him saying that there were sex noises coming from the basement, that would not be true?
That's not true.
Due to Michael's substance abuse history, we will never truly know exactly what happened that night that led to the death of James Whitaker. Michael used excessively, stating that earlier that evening he had done 6 lines. He likely suffered from memory loss and paranoia due to the long-term damage to his brain. Michael's mental state could have led him to believe a different reality than what was actually happening around him. For example, he may believe the stories he told were true, but it is more likely that he imagined Melody's life was in danger to validate his mood swings that is a result from his addiction. Another theory is that Michael and his daughter's relationship was discovered by James, so as paranoia set in, Michael reacted to an extreme. There are 2 big questions in this case. Was Melody involved, and was this premeditated? At first, this could look like self-defense, according to Michael's stories. However, his brother John testified in court and recounts a time when Michael asked to borrow his gun. John explains that he bought the gun off of Michael and they made a deal that he was able to borrow the gun whenever he wanted. Apparently, Michael borrowed that very gun he shot James with a month prior to the shooting. After a month of borrowing the gun, John found the gun under his daughter's bed after the date of the murder.
Whose gun was that?
Initially, it was Michael and Jimmy's gun.
Okay.
I bought it from my brother for $150. I paid him in payments over time. He didn't get the $150 for like, took him like 4 weeks. I think he was expecting it all at once. He was kind of bummed about the whole stretching it out. But that's how I acquired the gun. My brother asked to borrow it. He wanted to go hunting for deer. I wondered why he wanted to borrow my gun to go hunting. I mean, he had plenty of his own, and Jimmy certainly had plenty of guns.
Okay, so let me stop you right there, John. Michael had stated to you that he wanted to borrow your gun. Is that right?
Yes, because it hunted good. He had hunted with it before.
Okay. But that struck you as curious because Mike and James both have their own guns. Is that right?
Yeah.
But he wanted to borrow yours.
Yeah.
Did you let him borrow it?
It was an argument. But he eventually, I let him borrow it. Not when he came for it, but the next time he came around, we had a little scuffle, not a fight, but an argument about the gun, and I let him borrow it. Because when he sold it to me, he did ask me for permission to use it, to go hunting with it. So I let him, I thought nothing of it.
All right. Again, please keep your voice up, okay? How long was the, so you just gave him the gun?
Yeah.
How long was the gun gone until you saw it again?
I was thinking it was about 2 weeks, but it was about a month that he had it, I do believe.
Okay, when did you see it again?
A short time before all the cops came.
All right, a short time before all the cops came, is that what I heard?
Yes.
Okay, well, tell us about it. How did you see it? Where did you see it?
It was under my daughter's bed. It was there when I got home from work. I didn't notice it until I was laying down.
Before the investigators narrowed in on Michael as the prime suspect, they went to James's house, where they were residing, and interviewed Melody. We will hear Melody in the interview express that it wouldn't be surprising if James hurt himself, and that Melody and Michael were allowed to keep the house if he ever went MIA. The reason Melody was sure to mention self-harm as an option was because she knew part of the cover-up story was a fake suicide note that her father wrote in James's name. The subtext in the note was that there was a love triangle between Michael, his daughter Melody, and James. Assuming Michael or Melody wrote the note, they admitted that there was some level of inappropriate intimacy between father and daughter. The striatum plays a big role in reward experiences, which can lead to substance addiction. The damage to this area could alter the way one perceives rewarding experiences and can be manipulated into doing negative acts to achieve a desired reward. In Melody's case, her father could engage in intimate acts with her and reward her with the high she desired. In the interview with the investigator, Melody took long pauses when answering questions to think about how her responses will impact her claims of innocence. However, she contradicts herself instantly when she stated her knowledge, or lack thereof, about what happened to James.
Where's Mr. Whitaker at?
We haven't seen him. Last time we've seen him was the 5th.
Was the 5th?
Yeah.
Where did he go?
He was at the house, and we went over to our friend Hayes. And we came back around 5 a.m. And he wasn't home.
I mean, where would he go?
I don't know. I thought he went and just did something to himself or something. That's what he's been talking about.
You think that something's happened to Jim?
Well, he told me and Dad, he's like, I'm just gonna not be here anymore. And you guys can keep this place because my
anything unusual you guys getting home? Don't you think something may have happened to him? Or
just the fact that he was gone. He didn't say anything. Or even write anything. So you usually never left without writing a note or whatever.
He didn't leave a note.
He did leave one, but Dad had it put on a white cabinet. He doesn't want to live anymore because of the love of his life or whatever. I didn't read the note personally.
Okay.
But he handed it to me and I skimmed over it.
Melody told investigators that James had intimate feelings toward her. If this is true, then the motive for James demanding Melody to stay that night could have been for inappropriate reasons. It is understandable for a father to want to protect his daughter. Michael is usually quick to answer questions unless it involves Melody in any form. In one way or another, Melody was involved since she was in the house during the shooting in both versions of his story. Residents that lived down the street recounted in court testimony that Melody knocked on their door and asked to borrow gasoline. While normally this may not be out of the norm in their area to burn trash in their yards, the condition that Melody was in was suspicious. The residents recalled that when Melody approached their house that night, she was covered in blood. Depending on the blood spatter pattern, this could back up Michael's story that she was being held by James when he was shot. The splatter could also be from helping Michael move the body and cover up the crime. Conveniently, Michael did not know where Melody's clothes were from that night. We will hear Michael in his court testimony recount the lengths he went to clean up the crime scene and cover up the murder. He chopped up and burned James's body for 15 days.
Did you hear her at all over this time? Not, okay. When you went up there, did you see her?
Yes.
What did you tell her?
Go to the basement.
Okay. So she went off to the basement.
Yes.
What did you do at that point?
I went out to by the burn pile, got the deer sled, put him on it, and wheeled him out by the burn pit.
Did you do this by yourself?
Yes, I did.
Now, there's been some testimony about whether it's possible for a person to lift or drag another person. You've heard that testimony, right?
Yes.
You said you've gone hunting for deer before?
Yep.
What is the purpose of a deer sled?
Put the deer on it and drag it back.
Okay. Would you be able to do that with a deer that you couldn't otherwise lift on your own?
Yes.
Is the purpose of that sled to drag something that's heavy?
Yes.
Okay. And so you yourself are the sole person who dragged the body out to the burn pile?
Yes.
And then you said you dragged it out there to the burn pile, right?
Yes.
What did you do next?
I drug it out there, put it by the burn pile, got some brush, piled it around it. I've been up for probably 2 days. I went back to the house and laid down.
Okay. So you put it out there and then basically covered it with brush.
Yes.
And then you laid down on the house. How long were you lying down for?
Like 2 hours.
Okay. When you finally woke up, what happened next?
He'd come back up. I helped him work on his car. He left and it was probably about dark time. Then I went out, took the Coleman fuel and set him on fire.
Now, Mr. Dixon, I have to ask you this. You understand how that sounds, right?
It sounds awful.
Take note that Michael denies cutting up James's body, but unless he is willing to say that his daughter did, then there is no other explanation for all the cut marks on the bones. Michael is sure to not mention Melody in any of the process.
You know, and I can pull out each one of those gruesome weapons and show them to you, but like Dr. Harden said, she can't say that's the one that caused it. Neither can I. I can't tell you it was that saw. I can't tell you it was that chainsaw. I can't tell you it was that massive machete. But what we can tell you is that these bones were cut. And he said no one helped him. So if anybody's cutting these bones, cutting these arms, cutting these legs, cutting these bodies, these body parts, it's Michael Dixon. She confirmed that these two cuts, these three serrated cuts, are not from a chainsaw. But as you recall, what we have are these bone fragments. Hundreds of little bone fragments, these chipping of bones that had been subjected to fires for 15 days.
This footage is Michael showing the investigators how James's body and the gun were laying in the room once he was shot. He also took them through the house to show what he moved to hide the evidence. Michael moved a shelf that used to be against the wall in the middle of the room, and he moved the refrigerator. His thought was to cover stains that may be left behind. On May 2021, Michael was found guilty of 2 counts of murder, 1 count of felonious assault, 7 counts of tampering with evidence, 1 count of gross abuse of a corpse, and 1 count of engaging in a pattern of corrupt activity. He was later sentenced to 50 years to life in prison. On June 2021, Melody accepted a plea deal and pleaded guilty to 3 counts of evidence tampering and 2 counts of obstruction of justice. She was sentenced to 9 years in prison. There were requests that were denied for a mistrial. According to her defense team, Melody suffered from PTSD due to childhood abuse and trauma, which could have hindered her decision-making. It was also argued that her PTSD could have made her more vulnerable when confronted with her father's demand to help with the cover-up. Do you think Melody played a bigger role in the crime than Michael let on? Could this have been premeditated for other reasons? Or was it really to just protect his daughter in the moment? Thank you for watching, and join me next time when we explore the psychological maze of some of the most wicked people.